Hello there, and welcome to another devlog about the village building game I'm making alone with my own engine. In the last devlog I mentioned that I had to pause development for a few months due to some real life issues, and now I'm happy to report that development is on and I'm making a ton of progress. It's been almost a month since the last devlog, so let me tell you what I've been up to. The first thing I needed after such a long hiatus was a plan. I mean, I do have a very good idea of what mechanics and content I want to see in the final game, but they're all slightly abstract and there are just way too many of them. I have all that planned out in detail in the game's document files, but it doesn't help with deciding what exactly should I do right now. What I needed was a short-term plan, a certain milestone to reach, an MVP, if you like. By the way, MVP clearly stands for Minimal Version Playable. Don't ask me about the word order, it probably came from French. So I spent several days planning out said milestone, listing everything I want to see in it and figuring out the intended playthrough. At some point I found myself trying to make a plan so detailed that I won't even need to think when I start writing code, everything would already be planned out in full detail. I quickly found out that this doesn't quite work. Games are too flexible and unpredictable and it's almost impossible to fully design everything on paper without trying to actually implement it. So at some point I switched to writing good old code. The first days of writing code were a real struggle for me. You see, it's that stage of the project where you need to stop thoughtlessly adding some random prototypes and features, and instead you need to start carefully designing some reusable future-proof systems, unless of course you want your code to quickly turn into an unmanageable mess. However, you still have no foundation for doing that, no already working systems to refer to, no established conventions, patterns, and practices. What this means is that every new system, even a very simple one like spreading grass, requires you to make a dozen of random decisions. Should I store this value per each entity or should it be shared? Should this be a single system or should I split it into two separate systems? Etc, etc. However, after several days of bashing my head into this wall of uncertainty, things started to get smoother. Some working systems started to appear, some patterns started to emerge. Of course, they all might change in the future, but at least for now I have a systematic way of solving most problems. Speaking of systems, the first thing I was working on was grass spreading and dying. It might sound strange to start with such a small and specific thing, but there are good reasons for that. Firstly, grass is going to be an important early game resource. It can be used for crafting primitive beds, making thatched roofs and feeding animals. So it's important to make it a renewable resource. Secondly, it's a small and simple system which made it easier to start developing the conventions I've been talking about earlier. Lastly, and probably most importantly, it's a nice way of stress testing my ECS implementation. ECS stands for Entity Component System, which is an incredibly terrible name for one incredibly versatile programming pattern used in game development. There are many different implementations of it, even Unity has one, and of course I'm using my own implementation, which hasn't really been battle tested on large projects yet. By the way, while working on this grass mechanics, I tested how two different grass species would interact and fight for space. This will be important for some other mechanics that I'll probably talk about in some of the future devlogs. Anyway, I stumbled upon this really cool system with two species occupying separate regions and only touching in this tiny spot, where neither of them managed to defeat the other one. So, now that we have some grass, we need to harvest it, for which I made this harvesting tool. I'm still not quite sure about this growing from center selection mechanism, though it feels much better than you'd thought it should. Recall that I'm using a triangular grid as a base for everything, so something like a rectangular selection is not directly applicable here. Finally, I taught my little chunky villagers how to actually cut the grass. Cutting generates these patches of cut grass resource, which dry out after a random amount of time. Oh, and remember how I didn't want to use behavior trees for the AI and decided to use something called goal-oriented action planning? Well, it worked for the most primitive scenarios, but after some thought I realized that this pattern doesn't suit the needs of my game. I'll simply have way too many possible actions, states and goals, some of which even depend on other entities like specific resources or instrument types. It looks like a goal-oriented implementation of this would be very messy and inefficient. So I switched to some simple ad hoc pattern with just a queue of actions that need to be performed. I want this milestone that I'm working towards to be a fair representation of maybe the first hour of the final game. This means that it won't have a lot of content, but the major gameplay mechanics should be in place. One of them is requiring instruments to perform certain tasks, like a sickle to cut grass, which is exactly what I've implemented next. Now that I got some dried grass, I can make a tool to build simple hay beddings on the ground. I was experimenting with different designs to show the tool in the world, and found that this simple line drawing works quite well. Some more work on the AI and my villagers can finally craft something to sleep on. Then I moved on to getting wood, which is also an important early game resource. I added two new instruments, an axe and a saw, added a new tree trapping tool, and implemented all the required AI bits. And now my villagers can chop down a tree, clear it from branches and saw it into several logs. It's actually quite fun to watch the villagers do all that. By the way, speaking of the AI, remember how I rewrote everything using some ad hoc action queue pattern? Well, now I have noticed that these actions are becoming asynchronous, because sometimes an action needs to wait for something to happen, like for the villager to finish walking somewhere. They are also becoming hierarchical, because an action may split into several sub-actions. And finally, they need to be able to react to failure, like a villager not being able to reach their destination. Now, guess what AI programming pattern allows precisely for asynchronous, hierarchical, and potentially failing actions? You guessed it, behavior trees. I already had a suspicion that I'll have to use them eventually, and now that my code basically turned into a bad implementation of this pattern, I decided it's time to do the reasonable thing and rewrite the AI once again. It's good that I'm doing all this rewriting while the project is still pretty much just starting to take shape and while the AI is still of manageable size. I still don't really like this pattern, in particular because it can be very hard to debug, since all the logic is now spread across a myriad of behavior tree nodes. However, I can already see that my AI has become much cleaner and more robust, so there's that. You might have also noticed that I've disabled the cell shading and outlines. I'm constantly tweaking the visuals to see what works and what doesn't, and right now I'm kind of starting to dislike cell shading. In my case, it produces too many visual artifacts and removes too much detail. I might add outlines back, but in a slightly different way, based on unique object IDs instead of distance to the camera. And that's all I've got for you today. The game is slowly starting to take shape, we're making good progress, and I'm generally feeling very inspired and excited about it. We still have several devlogs before I reach the aforementioned milestone, so I'll see you in the next one. Bye bye!